Hello everyone. In this session, we are going to take up DNA topoisomerases. As the name suggests, these are enzymes that help in maintaining the DNA topology or changing the DNA topology. And when we mean by DNA topology, we are talking of higher order structures in DNA. And why is this so important, or why is this a relevant need for the cell? It is because, say for example, we understand that when a DNA is highly supercoiled or it is highly condensed, then the DNA is not accessible, say for gene expression. That means if an RNA pol has to come and bind to a particular gene, the gene is hidden because the DNA is supercoiled. So in order to make that gene available for the RNA polymerase to come and bind, in order for that gene to be transcribed into its corresponding mRNA, the accessibility of the DNA needs that the highly coiled DNA get unwound, especially at that particular region. So this is just an instance of explaining to you why DNA topoisomerases are relevant to a cell. So what are the outcomes of this session? You, of course, will understand that a very compact supercoiled DNA can be unwound and relaxed, as just mentioned. We will also be able to understand the significance of this property in enabling expression of genes, replication of DNA, recombination, etc. The enzymes, that is the DNA topoisomerases, are of different types with slightly different mechanisms. And we will also be able to understand that because of the kind of function that it has, DNA enzymes are targets. These DNA topoisomerases are targets for several drugs. Now, see, let us understand that you have a supercoiled DNA. So when you have a supercoiled DNA, okay, and say, for example, the DNA has to undergo replication. So a supercoiled DNA has to change topology in order that the DNA is able to replicate. So here you can obviously look at the fact that for the replication to happen, the DNA has to open. So this is a region where the DNA has unwound. And because this region has unwound, the DNA replication will begin at this point. Were it to remain this way, the accessibility of the machinery to carry out replication would be difficult, and also availability of the templates to carry out the replication would be difficult. So what we're basically trying to say is that from such a topology, to get into a topology like this, there has to be something that helps the topology to happen, or rather, because it is unwinding over here, at the other end it is overwinding. So in order for unwinding to happen at this position, there is a need that at this position also there is a relaxation or relaxing in the supercoiling. So all these instances are helped by a set of enzymes that are called as DNA topoisomerases. So DNA topoisomerases, the structure is such that it is able to bind to DNA, and because they are able to bind to the DNA, they are able to carry out the function of relaxing an overwound or an underwound DNA. These enzymes are ubiquitous. That means they are present in almost all different organisms across the different kingdoms. So you will find topoisomerases in viruses. You will find them in E. coli. You will find them in yeast. You will find them in human beings as well. So it is present in all cells. Now, when we look at DNA topoisomerases, let us understand the overall mechanism that it carries out. Here, what we are trying to look at is that supercoiled DNA, because of topoisomerase, can become relaxed. Also, a catenated DNA, because of topoisomerase, can become decatenated. So, what we understand is that due to the function or the catalytic activity or the enzymatic activity of DNA topoisomerase, a supercoiled DNA can change its topology such that it becomes relaxed. So an overwound DNA can become relaxed DNA, and a catenated DNA can separate. So you can have this as one and this as one by the process of topoisomerase, or by because of topoisomerase. So we're going to basically try to look at how does DNA topoisomerase carry out this. So let's consider that you have a DNA topoisomerase, and this DNA topoisomerase is able to cut the DNA at this point. So it has effectively the function of cutting. But please keep in mind that once the DNA topoisomerase cuts, it does not release the cut ends. Were it to release the cut ends, you would have immediately got a linear DNA. But that is not what it does. What it just does is it cuts, and the two cut ends are held on to by the topoisomerase itself. Once the DNA has been cut, here a gap is formed. So therefore, what happens is this other part of the DNA is able to swivel out from this gap. So let's look at it sequentially. Say this is the part of the DNA that will swivel out. So you will have it moving towards the gap, okay, like this. And once it reaches here, it is able to come out. So when it comes out, you will get a relaxed DNA. And after coming out, the portion where the DNA was cut is again resealed by the DNA topoisomerase itself. So what do you observe over here? You observe that one rib has been decreased because of the topoisomerase. And that release of one rib is making the DNA a relaxed form. So effectively what therefore we understand is that because the DNA topoisomerase cuts, enables swiveling of the DNA through the gap formed, and seals the cut ends, it is able to cause relaxation of DNA. Interestingly, this mechanism varies slightly in different DNA topoisomerases, and hence based on the mechanism of action, the DNA topoisomerases are divided into two main classes. So let us first look at class 1. Now, consider that you have a DNA which is already supercoiled, and there are three negative supercoils. Now, to this supercoiled DNA, the topoisomerase from class 1 can come and bind, okay? And on binding to that, you see it binds to one double helix, right? It is binding to the helix. On binding to the helix, this enzyme is able to nick the DNA. Now, what do we mean by nick the DNA or form a nick in the DNA? It basically means that the enzyme is able to break a phosphodiester bond. So the enzyme per se in its active site has a tyrosine. This tyrosine has an OH group. We all know that the amino acid has OH as its R group. In its R group. So the OH that is present in the tyrosine is able to make a nucleophilic attack, and on making the nucleophilic attack, the phosphorus moiety of the phosphodiester bond is now in a bond with the tyrosine. And the OH, so the phosphodiester bond is broken. But like I mentioned earlier, this tyrosine is holding on to the phosphate part of the phosphodiester bond, and the topoisomerase through another amino acid will hold on the OH. So although the red colored strand now has a nick, it is not released. It is held on by the DNA topoisomerase still. But what is present now is a gap because of the cut. So this blue strand, that is the other strand, now is basically free. You can see that it is not any longer crossing the other strand. In fact, what happens is this becomes free. So what will now happen is that the blue strand, which was going from below this, now can be present up. Can you see that? And on sealing, the red strand is now sealed in such a way that this blue strand has come from down to top. It was down, now it is on top. So this blue DNA strand, or this strand of the DNA, has swiveled out from its position through that gap. Therefore, when the DNA topoisomerase after resealing the phosphodiester bond, okay? This topoisomerase, when it leaves the double-stranded DNA, at this point, you can actually have the DNA open. So one twist is less. So you can see that the DNA in this region where the topoisomerase worked on is now relaxed. Okay, interestingly, there is a cut, and the cut makes a phosphodiester bond break, but that phosphate moiety is held on by the tyrosine, so the energy is stored in this bond. And this energy that is stored in the bond is used again to form the resealing or form the phosphodiester bond again, which means that the DNA topoisomerase class 1 does not really require an ATP to carry out this job of breaking the bond and sealing the bond again or reforming the bond again. So what is the understanding? That the DNA topoisomerase class 1 is able to relax both overwound and underwound DNA. It has two subclasses, that is type 1A and type 1B. So structurally, the enzymes are slightly different, just making a little difference, but the mechanism remains the same, and therefore they are clubbed under the class 1. Also, what is interesting is that topoisomerases 1, 3, and 5 fall under this class 1, DNA topoisomerase. Yes, we all observe that these can relax the overwound and the underwound DNA, but there is an exception in reverse gyrase, which belongs to class 1. The reverse gyrase, in fact, introduces a positive supercoil, and for introducing the positive supercoil, it is using ATP. So except for this reverse gyrase, okay, all the other enzymes present in this class 1 behave the same, or the mechanism of the action is exactly the same. Reverse gyrase, however, is introducing a positive supercoil so it is making a DNA more wound. So it is not relaxing the DNA, but it is in fact increasing the coiling of the DNA. Now we come to the class 2. So the class 2 is slightly different in its mechanism of action from the class 1, and also therefore structurally it is different. This is an example of DNA topoisomerase 2, which falls under class 2. So you can see here that the DNA topoisomerase 2 can exist in different conformations. So this is one conformation and this is another conformation. When it is present in this conformation, it can bind to a double helix. Now, please understand that when you have a supercoiled DNA, this is just one helical part of the DNA. Say you have this segment, which is the other part of the same helical DNA. Okay. Now, this DNA topoisomerase, what it does is it will cut this segment over here. And after cutting this segment, so it forms a nick. But the nick is such that it is not cutting one strand of the helix, it is cutting both the strands of the helix. So you don't have a cutting in one phosphodiester bond, you have cutting of two phosphodiester bonds. So here what is happening is the entire helix is cut. So the double strand is cut. So in case of class 2 DNA topoisomerases, the cut is that of two strands, not one strand. So that is one major difference that is there from class 1 DNA topoisomerases. So it makes a cut such that the cut drives across the entire double strand, and after making the cut, this two parts of the topoisomerase holds the two cut ends. So you can see one cut end is held by this subunit, the other cut end is held by this subunit. So effectively, it does not release the cut ends. It holds on to the cut ends, just like DNA topoisomerase 1 also did. Now, having cut the two strands, there is a gap between the two strands. So the other segment of the DNA is held to by these two subunits. You can see that the conformation changes. It is bringing in this segment towards this, and through this gap, this segment is going off. Now, for this conformational change, you will find that ATP is required. So therefore, this ATP molecule helps change in conformation and it drives this other segment through. Once it drives the other segment through, it comes out. So you can see that through a gap that is formed by the DNA topoisomerase, the other segment is crossing or it is swiveling out. After it has swiveled out, you can observe immediately that the DNA topoisomerase seals the cut DNA. After it seals the cut DNA, this is one entire segment again, and this is another entire segment, but the positions have changed. You have the T segment present here first, but after the DNA topoisomerase carries out its enzymatic activity, the T segment is here. So you can look at it this way, that through G segment, the T segment went across. And that happened because there was a gap created because of the cut formed by the DNA topoisomerase too. So by the look of it, the mechanism is same. But what is the difference? In case of DNA topoisomerase 1, class 1, you had just a cut in one strand of the double helix. But in case of class 2 DNA topoisomerase, the cut is in two strands of the helix. And this class of enzyme uses ATP, whereas class 1 does not use ATP. Effectively, therefore, look at this. When the two strands of the DNA is cut, this part swivels from the gap and becomes relaxed. When you have a catenated DNA, if there's a cut formed over here, this can go out from here to form two. So effectively, DNA topoisomerase 2 enables both this to happen. It has subclasses type 2A and type 2B. And under this or comprising or within this class 2 is present the DNA topoisomerases 2, 4 and 6. It relaxes supercoils and introduces negative supercoils. Therefore, it has found a big place in DNA replication. Let us therefore go to understanding and look at what are the different functions that are being carried. So we'll just go through it quickly. It helps accessing DNA during transcription such that the gene can be expressed. So when a gene has to be expressed, and if it is in an overwound DNA, then that region of the DNA is underwound or it is relaxed by the DNA topoisomerase so that gene can be expressed. Overall, you will observe that DNA supercoils are removed for transcription, replication, recombination, etc. Just have a look over here. When you have the covalent closed circular DNA, and because of replication, when you have the two strands over here unwinding, okay, since the number of twists are decreasing over here, what is happening is the number of rids are going to increase over here. So at these regions are going to become more and more supercoiled, so positively supercoiled, because this region is becoming unwound. So that has to do with linking number is equal to twisting number plus ridding number. However, if this gets positively supercoiled, unwinding of DNA at this position is going to be difficult. So when the replication reaches these regions will have to be relaxed. So the relaxing of these regions are carried out by the DNA topoisomerase. Therefore, it plays a very important role. If replication has to go through, then the DNA has to unwind. And for DNA to unwind, supercoiling has to be relaxed. So therefore, DNA topoisomerase plays a very important role in replication. It helps in the process of DNA recombination as well. You would be familiar with DNA recombination when you understand in meiosis, exchange of genes through the formation of chiasma. So that is what DNA recombination is. So to break the strands, DNA topoisomerases help. It helps in chromosome condensation by introducing supercoils. So when you want the DNA to condense, to become more compact, then the DNA topoisomerase can introduce supercoils so that it becomes more compact. It can open a knotted DNA or it can untangle a tangled DNA. So these are some of the functions that DNA topoisomerases carry out all the time. DNA topoisomerases, therefore, have been the targets of several anti-cancer drugs, as these enzymes are involved in DNA replication. Now, we all know that in cancer, there is a continuous division of cells. If the cells have to keep on dividing, understanding the cell cycle, the S phase replication in the S phase is going to happen. So it's basically, if the cells are to divide, the DNA has to replicate. So if there is a way by which you can prevent replication, you may be able to prevent cell division itself. So topoisomerases being needed for enabling the unwinding of the DNA by relaxing the DNA. If you do not have the relaxing of DNA to unwind the DNA, then replication may stop. And that is why it is a anti-cancer drug target. So we just read out the conclusions. DNA topoisomerases are enzymes that can modify supercoiling by either relaxing an unwound DNA or an overwound DNA. They are able to introduce negative supercoils or also introduce positive supercoils. Based on their mechanism of action, they are divided into two main classes, class 1 and class 2. The class 1 cuts only a single strand of a helix and does not require ATP. And the class 2 cuts two strands of a helix and requires ATP. Thus, DNA topoisomerases are a group of enzymes that help in topological changes in DNA only for a cause, and that is to enable different functions in the cell. Thank you.